The Imperial Navy is the greatest space-going military force of the 41st millennium, and perhaps in the whole of history. Only its need to safeguard the million worlds of the Imperium prevents it from dominating the entire galaxy. And now it is time to teach you how to be among the elite. Hello there everyone, I'm going to be doing a bit of a rundown on the core concepts towards the Imperial Navy and how you can ideally get the most out of them. We're going to talk about their traits, what's unique about them, but ultimately, the Imperial Navy are mostly kind of the introductory type of faction to Battlefleet Gothic Armada 2, that and the Chaos Forces, for they are kind of designed to be well-rounded with their own unique playstyle, at least differentiating between these two factions at least. But nonetheless, they have their strengths, they have their weaknesses, and it's good to know what these are so you can utilize them to your best potential. As a result of them being a well-rounded type of fleet, they have, as you would expect, pretty generic stat lines in almost every regard. They have no modifier to their bravery bonus, their troops are pretty average in their boarding efficiency, and they have the generic, like, all-ahead full and, what is it, high energy turn, which most of the factions have access to. Where the Imperial Navy differs, they are sheer brute force in close, if you can get it in the point-blank range potential, and their sheer heavily armored prowess went comboed with the fact that all their torpedo-type cruisers and battleships have access to spurs. And these spurs, which are unique to the Imperial Navy with the exception of maybe one or two other ships and other factions, allow you to do additional ramming damage right off the bat and a ridiculous 300% bonus damage if you were to ever hit an escort ship or a frigate of any kind. This encourages a lot of close-range potential play. It's already hinted at by the fact that the majority of the Imperial Navy fleet are equipped with torpedoes. And when you top that off, that the Imperial Navy also have access to melted torpedoes, which in prospect are not very damaging in a lot of situations, but they give you a lot of longevity, at least, for drawn-out type of fights. Whereas most other factions only get 3 shots of their torpedoes, the Imperial Navy are a lot more comfortable with 6 different salvos that they can utilize based on the situation at hand. The melted torpedoes, strictly put, when they hit, put a fire assault on the enemy ship, and while it can be repaired immediately with your emergency repair, if left unchecked, this will do an absurd amount of burning damage, equated to like a grand total of 90 damage for the 45 second duration that these fire effects cause. It also has the added bonus of doing a lot of morale damage, as is a given due to the nature of Battlefleet Gothic. But like I said, these torpedoes can easily be mitigated by emergency repair, so a lot of the time you want to combo this with either a second wave to kind of punish the emergency repair, or just plan out your engagement during this point where they're unable to deal with engine damage or any weapons being destroyed as a result of their emergency repair being put on cooldown. So this is the ultimate synergy you have with this type of Imperial Navy fleet, due to the aggressive nature of the fleet. However, getting in close can be really tricky due to the fact that all your weaponry almost exclusively is on the broadside of the ship, so the starboard and prow are where the majority of your weaponry is going to be based at. And while they have really good long-range potential in their battle cruisers and their battleships, your cruisers and light cruisers have a lot shorter range to their macro cannons, so they will have a difficult time fighting at a distance. Facing off against anything that's mobile will encourage you to kind of be utilizing these weapons more, as getting close can be tricky, if not incredibly punishing, due to your lack of weaponry being able to fire on the opponent. They're also one of the only other of the two factions, at least currently in Armada 2, to have access to Grand Cruisers, and while these differ greatly from the rest of the Imperial Navy fleet, they do provide a lot of firepower potential. They are a lot more simpler to control due to the fact that they do not have torpedoes on their prow, which allows them to focus their fire a lot better to the singular role that a lot of these ships are equipped for. The Exorcist is kind of a massive carrier ship with at least potent firepower on the broadside. The Avenger is strictly a close-range type of brawler. And the Vengeance is a good long-range type of harasser with a good range of lances in comparison to other Imperial Navy ships, which have really short-range type of lances. So if you're going to be utilizing a lance-centric build, this has potential for you. A lot of your battleships are also very diverse and unique in their playstyles, for only the Retribution is truly the one that encompasses the traditional type of torpedo and heavy prow armor that you're kind of used to with how I explained with like all the other Imperial Navy ships. The other battleships, which includes the Emperor, which is your heavy a carrier battleship, which has extended identification range for situations to spot ships at a longer range. The Apocalypse is kind of strictly a lance-type ship, with the means to greatly enhance the range of the lances should it ever have lock-on available. It is also equipped with a Nova Cannon, making it a very powerful opponent if you can bring the shields down aimed at appropriately. And Oberon is a bit of an interesting hybrid type ship equipped with a little bit of everything. It has two carrier bays, two lance batteries, and two macro cannons, all for longer range potential. It kind of follows the role of the Emperor should the need for additional fighter base not be warranted. But the majority of the fleet that you are going to be accustomed to, as I said, are going to be centralized around the use of torpedoes. Almost all the ships in the game, hell, even the good portion of the light cruisers also have access to torpedoes. But they also do have the means to utilize Nova Cannons with three different types of ships in this fleet. The Mars, the Dominator, and as I hinted at already, the Apocalypse. And these are incredibly potent type of long range weapons. They are limited by the fact they only get three shots available to them. And due to the closer range potential of these Nova Cannons, you are going to need to get a little bit creative or be willing to successfully brute force your way through shields, as shields on most of these factions are a great way to mitigate the damage potential that these Nova Cannons can do. Now, let's talk about how a generic type of match is going to play out for most Imperial Navy fleets, since, as I said, there are different types of playstyles, but this is going to go with the assumption that you're focused on the torpedo type of style. I'll briefly talk over the other type of potential fleets later on this video, but for now, with the torpedo type fleets, you kind of want to make sure they're spread out a little bit, or at least not positioned in a way during your deployment phase that if you need to turn your fleet, that they're not actually going to be intervene with other ships firing their torpedoes. So things like your Retribution, which has slower turning radius, never mind its longer size or larger size, is going to have a hard time hitting things if Overlords or Tyrant's cruisers get in the way. And ideally, due to the fact that you have six torpedo salves available to you, a lot of the times you will want to try and do some light harassment or chipping damage to your opposing adversary as you are going towards the middle of the map and capturing your points. Although, it does come with, you do need to be mindful of the faction you're up against, for like, factions like the Necrons are completely immune to fire effects, so your melted torpedoes are going to be completely useless in that matchup. And in the case of orcs, which have the opposite effect, they are a lot more susceptible to melted torpedoes. So understanding the matchups is pretty key to what kind of torpedoes you want to utilize. As you get closer into melee range, if that is a realistic possibility for the matchup, you would probably want wanting to hang on to those torpedoes specifically, like melted torpedoes as they hinted at for against orcs, and regular damage torpedoes against Necrons. You want to hang on to them for when you have the most likely chance to do damage with them. And then otherwise, the type formation is pretty damn key in general, as a general rule, for most fleets, as it allows you to protect your ships if they are starting to take hull damage and you're not able to do retaliatory fire due to either not detecting enemy ships yet, or you're just not in range to effectively do the damage necessary. You are going to be leaving yourself vulnerable to inconvenient engine critical hits, so just maneuvering ships behind your retribution or boosting them behind obstructions or into gas clouds can be good to help weather that storm as you make your way forward. And if you are kind of forced to a longer range engagement, you kind of want to turn your side and position yourself within a nice sweet spot of objectives to kind of force the opponent to get closer to you if you can drag it out and mitigate the damage pretty well. If the opponent takes the bait or you're able to snare them or catch them in the close range engagement, then you are greatly increasing the accuracy of your macro cannons, and due to the fact that the Imperial Navy does have slightly slower projectile speed for their macro cannons, this makes it a lot harder for your opponent to evade them or at least just dodge them in general due to accuracy. And in situations like this, if you are good with your high energy turn control, you are able to use your prowess to kind of do some significant ramming damage comboed with the torpedoes. You almost always want to have your torpedoes launched at the same time you do this kind of ramming maneuver, just because of how close you are to the opponent. It does come down to a case-by-case basis, like the angle you're coming from. It easily offsets the amount of damage you're neglecting due to the fact that your prow is facing the opponent and not getting the most potential with your macro cannons as a result. But due to the fact that both your ramming and your torpedoes both ignore shields, this is not a terrible thing, all things considered, especially if you're equipped with like a disruption bomb or other type of abilities that will help negate the shield for you. Since a lot of the times, if you have that ability available to you or are able to destroy generators due to prioritize them, it makes your life a lot more convenient that way. Since until the shields are down and you have a way to deal with them, your macro cans are kind of pointless in that regard, or you're just wasting fire. So by all means, get in close there and do the damage necessary. A lot of the times the brace for impact is not necessary, it just depends on the kind of damage you're expecting. Pay close attention to the morale of your ships, for with your heavily armored prow, you're not going to take a significant amount of morale damage. It's when you're getting hit on the side or taking heavy fire as a result of this point-blank range engagement. That's where the morale damage is primarily going to be coming from and going to hinder you greatly. Even with that all said, shields are really easy to take down. You'll bring them down almost immediately with a full salvo of broadside weaponry at point-blank range. So they are ultimately going to just soak a single salvo or barrage of fire, if not potentially two for the case of like a battleship. So you need to be able to keep your broadside facing your opponent if you want to do the permanent damage that's required to eventually kill off the ships. But if you are just focusing on the ramming damage and torpedoes, then you've got good tempo swing there, because the damage you'll be doing in most situations, even against Space Marines and Necrons with their 83 armor all around, you are going to just come out on top in most of those situations just because of the additional health that your ships have as opposed to theirs. You just will have to account for the fact that they are firing their weapons on you in most of those circumstances, however. Which is why the torpedoes are so valuable if you're going to commit to the ramming. But if you have upgrades like the short burn torpedoes, this allows you consistent and reliable damage a lot of the time with the torpedoes at like medium range. And by medium range, I'm talking about 9,000 or 13,500 unit range. That would be considered roughly around medium long range there, due to the increased speed that the torpedoes give you, especially when you're facing off against an immobile type of fleet and are not able or not willing to just yet commit to a close range engagement. As far as boarding is concerned there, since your troop damage is going to be very minor, if you were expecting to kill off the crew of any ship, you should be focused almost exclusively on a cruiser or maybe a light cruiser of some sort, if you want to kill off the crew quickly. If you feel that a longer engagement is going to be apparent due to the fact that you're facing off against heavy armor or not equipped for a close range engagement, or your opponent's able to keep distance from you to get the full potential of your macro batteries, then maybe focusing on a battleship or a battle cruiser might be more warranted long term to cripple it. But ideally, most of the time you want to use your boring to kind of get the critical hits, since that is where you're more likely to get at least immediate damage. This is mechanics going to be getting changed after this video, so there's going to be a lot of nuances to the boring itself. As a general rule, at least, you want to be boring something for the purposes of critical hits, as killing off the crew is not going to be likely, especially if they are more superior at boarding or have higher crew complement in general. Make good use of your high energy turn. While you have to be very careful not to burn out all your combustion gauge, as that's going to be essential for mitigating a lot of your damage, since the macro cannons have an incredibly long rate of fire, at least in comparison to other macro batteries. So while I talk about how difficult it can be to use your weaponry, your broadsides, it's not a huge issue if you got the high energy turn available for your cruisers, since they can conveniently turn, lob the torpedoes, and then turn back to the broadside heading to keep their cannons firing almost completely unhindered. This will burn a lot of your combustion gauge, mind you, so you need to be smart with how you utilize this. It is also possible, at least with like the light cruisers, due to their much higher turning radius speed, to get full firepower from both your broadside weaponries. This requires a high amount of micromanagement on your Dauntlesses and burns a drastic amount of combustion gauge, mind you, but allows you to at least have it maximize damage if a kill needs to be done almost immediately. You just rapidly rotate the Dauntless a full 180 degrees, maybe lobbing torpedoes if it's equipped for it, and you get to fire with both broadside weaponry to try and accelerate the kill of a very fragile target. But ideally, this is not a very practical type of use of your combustion gauge. Really, you just want to have your prow turn to them, lob torpedoes, and open up for a ramming potential due to the sheer amount of combustion gauge that's utilized to return back to your broadside heading. Novacan type of fleets will vary a little bit in this playstyle, for the Dominators have arguably the best close range macro weaponry for all of the Imperial Navy, outside maybe the Avenger, which just has more macro weapons to its advantage, but the Dominator nonetheless has the most potent. But with the Novacan, that can make it tricky to bring down shields, which can mitigate so much of the Novacan damage. So ideally what you want to do is combine that with either disruption bomb or a stasis bomb to help increase the likeliness of doing the permit damage you wish. Or if you are able to disengage and keep at like the 9,000 unit range you need to be able to fire Novacan on your ship because you're strafing past them in your ram attempt, do keep in mind that the Dominators, while they still have the 83 armor, they do not have spurs, as they were replaced with the Novacans, so you're not going to be doing as much ramming damage with them, but they still have the 83 armor to heavily mitigate any ramming damage they do take. Though ideally what you would want to do if you want to take advantage of shields being down is kind of boost on through when you get in a close range, let your macro cannons punch through the shields rapidly in a little bit of hull damage, and as your opponents are trying to either evade you or try to get themselves turned around to do another broadside attack on you, this is where you use your high energy turn to get yourself positioned to fire Novacan as you get some distance from your opponent. And it also helps to have your Dominator spread out a tiny bit, not so much that your fleet gets easily isolated, but at least keeping maybe one or two on kind of the side or flank or already past the fleet, so that way it can take full advantage without your entire fleet having to disengage. It can be really tricky to utilize the Novacans otherwise, since shields will mitigate a lot of this damage for you, unless you have an all Dominator or all Novacan type of fleet, which it can be pretty fragile due to the lack of frigates or other utility ships you have to face off against all the possible factions you may encounter. And the Grand Cruisers kind of suffer from this a tiny bit. They almost exclusively broadside weaponry with a little bit more health in comparison to their cruisers. And they do lack the heavy prow armor, so ramming damage is a lot more significant for them. And it also means they take additional morale damage on those rams if they are not using the brace for impact stance. But if you are able to harass them due to their bigger size, one of the unique traits of the Imperial Navy is how narrow they are, which makes them really good at dodging torpedoes just by flying directly towards your opponent, or flying directly away if the situation warrants it. The Grand Cruisers are a little more bulbous in that sense, just slightly, so they're a little more fragile torpedoes, and if their prow is facing you, they're almost doing no damage to you outside the risk of ramming. So being able to take full advantage of your number of torpedoes, at least against Grand Cruisers, will help in that regard some. But otherwise, the Grand Cruisers are probably the simplest type of playstyles to utilize due to the fact that they only have one type of weapon and the means to do the ramming damage when it's warranted for striking down something quickly due to shields being recharged. There's also a little bit of a niche fleet potential there in a lance-based type of fleet with the Apocalypse and Armageddons. And at first glance, this may seem like a really odd fleet, but you gotta keep in mind this is like two extremes mashed together. Lances always hit their target, so this encourages you fighting at extreme range at almost all times. But when you combo the fact that the Armageddons have the heavier prow as well as spurs, if your opponent does get aggressive, you can punish them with the torpedoes and the additional ramming damage. Kind of like how I hinted before, with your type of run-by strategies and ramming potential, you're going to do an absurd amount of damage with your torpedoes and ramming combo together, especially if you can do the chipping damage necessary to make the enemy ship vulnerable to just immediately getting destroyed by the strafing run. It is perhaps one of the more difficult type of fleets, mind you, due to the fact that they don't have the best in macro weaponry to defend themselves in close, so you need some way to disengage or at least be very good at keeping your distance and spotting the targets consistently to do the lance damage necessary. Now I'm going to talk about my own personal fleet that I've been utilizing during my time with the Imperial Navy. This is what I would consider more of a well-rounded type of fleet, not really focused in something exclusively, as there's like 12 different factions and numerous different types of playstyles you need to be prepared for after all. But they do focus a lot on utilizing the macro cannons at close range and doing an absurd amount of damage with torpedoes if I can get the jump on my opponent. There's the Retribution, which I'm using as my main flagship, two Tyrants, which are my close range damage dealers, my Exorcist, which also has macro cannons for close range, but it's primarily a carrier ship to help deal with its torpedoes and lots of fighters, while also having a Dauntless Mark II, a Falchion, and two Cobras to serve as my scouts, my harassers, and to kind of be equipped to deal with opposing frigates in a lot of circumstances. And ideally, the strategy behind this fleet is pretty straightforward. I use the Tyrants to protect the Retribution due to its lower mobility and lack of higher G turn, while also lobbing torpedoes at range there, ideally during a period where I believe I can get engagement with my opponent while their emergency repairs are still down. I normally fire with at least one melted torpedo salvo, possibly two, but I ideally save it for when we're about to get into firing range and before I turn my broadside to do some harassing chipping damage. A lot of the times, if your face-off is against something that might be mobile, I would probably turn to kind of bully the opponent back some. But otherwise, if the map warrants a lot of control points that I want to secure, I'm going to turn my broadside to the opponent and just hold my position once I'm in a certain sweet spot, using my cruisers to kind of shield each other as they're taking hull damage, and just circling around each other. It can be really tricky, however, to get aggressive when you turn your broadside to your opponent since of the amount of time it will take without utilizing your high energy turn, since you really do need your combustion gauge to be as fully charged as possible if you're going to make a sprint in on your opponent. But I do have the Retribution equipped with a Microwarp Jump to kind of serve as distraction as well as get almost immediate torpedo salvo in on an opponent if they're caught unprepared or have burned their combustion gauge prematurely to an extremist extent. And when I do plan my engagements, more often than not, I charge in there when certain cooldowns are in effect, like if they launch fighters or like seeker missiles or torpedoes at me, then I use that as an opportunity to turn my prow to them, for the narrower profile makes it a lot more easier to avoid and mitigate that torpedo damage. And since they don't have a way to punish me when I get in close for that same reason, since normally torpedoes are a lot more effective in close, I charge in there as they're ideally facing me or while those are down, so that way they cannot punish me and get the burst damage in effect. A perfect example would be like the Tau Protector Fleet, which almost every single one of their ships have a combination of both seeker missiles and fighters and bombers to combo together. And if you let those hit you when you do an aggressive push, then you're going to have a massive tempo disadvantage, as one of your ships have almost immediately lost half their health most assuredly if you are not adequately prepared for that salvo weapon fire. But if you can deflect that and then retaliate almost immediately, those seeker missiles are still going to be on cooldown, and the bombers have like a 1 minute cooldown, so they are not going to be able to do anything until you're already in your sweet spot position, if the opponent hasn't already turned around and tried to disengage entirely, in which case their prow focused weaponry are not going to do any damage to you at all outside of their bombers. You do need to be careful when you get aggressive, of course, since this leaves your objectives to getting captured by frigates that are flanking. That's always the risk, which is why you need to be precise and really understand what it is you're waiting for when you do your aggressive push. As I hinted at with the Tau Protector Fleet, you kind of want to wait until their seeker missiles and bombers are on cooldown. For like Necrons, as another example, you want to wait until they use their inertialess drive, because otherwise they can just jump away. You kind of burn a lot of your torpedoes if they jump as a response to you launching a torpedo salvo. Or ideally, if they're more close range based and they have the scarab swarm, you kind of want to ideally wait until that burns off, so that way you're not taking a ridiculous amount of damage from your entire fleet. As far as components you should try and prioritize, it's almost exclusively going to be the engines, unless you're confident that you're better equipped for a longer range engagement. Since if you're face off against orcs, you kind of want to avoid a close range engagement until you soften them up with melted torpedoes or just your torpedoes and macro cannons in general. Start getting those critical hits in to kind of hinder them down. But destroying the engines is almost a general rule for almost all factions, as it allows you to get in close that much more better, and it allows some of the ships that do have crippled engines to get isolated and allow you to focus them down really quickly. And the Exorcist in this situation is still really good when it gets in close, because the bombers at close range means they're more likely going to survive their bombing run, as opposed to when you do it at longer range when your opponent has time to see them coming and know which ship they're going after. While the Exorcist may look like it's a longer range type of ship with his bombers, it benefits nicely with the close range aggression as well, due to the fact that it has a lot more likeliness of the ship surviving, let alone succeeding in doing its bombing or boarding runs on the enemy cruiser. I don't use the brace for impact stance very often. Due to what I said, since you have such heavy prowess, you're not taking nearly as much morale damage as most other factions would. But if you are worried about heavy boarding or unleash your decks being destroyed, you may need to consider the brace for impact to help at least slow down that process. But really, the brace for impact only slows down the damage you're taking and is really used for dealing with fighters at longer range. If you're facing off against tower heavy fighter fleets like carrier Tyranids and carrier orc fleets. And a lot of the times when I'm facing off against those type of fleets, I kind of try to stack two charges of fighters on the Exorcist, keeping it in back as much as I can, so that way it doesn't get picked off, or at least they don't get activated by fighters that are not quite in range of the point defense of the Retribution and Tyrants. To be able to weather the storm of a heavy fighter and bomber fleet, you really do need to make sure the cruisers are defending your fighters, since you only have a single cruiser that actually has fighters. If it's not defended and you're not doing damage to the opposing bomber squadrons and fighters quickly, then you're going to easily have your fighters get shot down quickly just due to sheer number of disadvantage. And while normally the frigates are going to be stealing points in the back, with saying upgrades like the short burn torpedoes, they can do essential flanking damage at a distance. You do need to be careful with not hitting your own ships, especially when in close range. But if you are facing things that are not as mobile like Necrons and Orcs, then they can easily get some free damage in while having no risk to them. And finally, let's talk about some of the unique noteworthy type of skills you probably want to consider when utilizing an Imperial Navy type of fleet. We have the Disruption Bomb. If you find that doing damage to the shields is really problematic with, like I hinted at with the Nova Cans, or even just maximizing your damage potential with the Macro Cans, since you cannot get critical hits while the shields are up. So if you were doing a charging run with your torpedoes and ramming, this is a good window for you to drop down a Disruption Bomb in preparation for your broadsides to do maximum damage. You only have 3 charges there and there is a 15 second windup time, so you do need to have some good foresight to drop this down properly without hitting your own ships, or worst case, having your macro cans fire before the Disruption Bomb goes off. Stasis Bomb can work amazingly well in some very niche situations, since you can combo with your torpedoes really well. It gives you proper time to set it up if you get ships stuck in it. It does again require a lot of planning and foresight to time it properly due to the 15 second charge up and the additional 20 seconds of the Stasis Bomb itself. Since if you fire torpedoes too soon, your torpedoes are likely just going to get shot down, since they're also going to get slowed down by the Stasis Bomb. Micro Warp Jump is really damn important, at least for a singular type of flagship. If you're worried about taking damage with your morale, or your flagship is either a battleship or a grand cruiser or something larger scale and more impactful, this allows you to mitigate a lot of its immobility, allows you to protect it a little bit better, or to just use it as bait more often than not. And then otherwise, Power Rams, while currently it does not work properly, I'm positive during this version, this will ideally do additional ramming damage to any ships that have spurs on them. So you're essentially doing double damage, possibly, with the Power Rams itself, which makes your torpedo and ramming potential that much more vicious. In the case of the Armageddon, which has a spur on it while having no real macro cans in close, this allows you to chip things down at long extreme range, and when you're ready to go in there, you can almost immediately kill a lot of light cruisers and cruisers, provided you did enough damage with your lance-based weaponry ahead of time to soften up to just immediately kill these ships with an effective ram combo. Short burn torpedoes are a pretty significant type upgrade if you want to use your torpedoes for longer range harassment. It's not really essential in close, since with high energy turns giving you the convenience to just turn your prow to fire torpedoes at opportunistic moments. Short burn torpedoes allows you to harass and use them for more medium range potential, as I hinted at before, and giving your opponent a lot less time to dodge them as a result. The Kulexis Assassin can be a pretty useful type of upgrade if you want to cause mutinies on a specific type of ship, mainly the enemy flagship perhaps, to start easily getting rid of it quickly and forcing its rally to get burnt preemptively. But this can be pretty impactful just debuffing a crew if you can do the morale damage before to hand, since your melted torpedoes synergize amazingly with this, provided you can get the fire results to start chipping down the morale damage ahead of time. Armor-piercing ammunition. While this is going to get nerfed very soon, it basically functions like any other lance weapon and armor-piercing type of weapon currently, provided you're in short range, which is 4,500 unit range. And even with the nerf, it's still going to be an incredibly powerful weapon, since it's going to reduce armor by about 15, I believe, as the time of this recording, which essentially will do almost double damage in comparison to not having this upgrade. At least if you're faced off against 83 armor like the Space Marines, the prow of like another Imperial Navy or Orc ship, or the Necrons, this will allow you to essentially do double damage with your macro cannons, which cannot be overstated. Reducing armor down to 50 will roughly equate to doing maybe 2.5 times the damage as opposed to the 2-time damage you're doing with the nerf. But it's still very noteworthy and something you should seriously look at for any type of fleet composition that utilizes macro cannons. The Agrippina pattern void shields is more for something when you want to have longer range type of engagements, so something like this might be more warranted for lance type play due to how encouraged you are to stay at range. But giving armor shields is kind of a very subtle thing, and I believe it also works against Nova cannons to a limited extent. This requires some playtesting and is kind of more of a niche type upgrade. And this is what I would hope to be a basic rundown to the playstyle of the Imperial Navy and how to get the most out of them. A lot of their playstyle will encourage the use of a lot of torpedoes, but there's always room to diversify as well and accustom your playstyle to more longer range type of nuances. So there is possibility to get aggressive. You just need to be prepared to get into the thick of it, and whether you're long range based with lances or even with Nova cannons, you have the close range firepower to be a threat to anything. You are a well-rounded fleet that excels in close no matter the equipment you're utilizing. So thank you everyone for tuning in, and I will see you on the battlefield.